that you are placing beyond the measurement, that is again defining the classification of a particular measurement technique. So this is how we can classify different type of transducers. So transducers are basically classified, revising briefly, in two different categories, electrical and non-electrical. Further classifying them, it can be classified as either active transducer or passive transducers. Active transducers called self-generating transducers, which can generate the signal on its own, does not require power supply. Passive transducers are those which cannot generate signal on its own. It requires either AC or DC excitation in order to perform the conversion. Followed by another category, contacting or non-contacting type of transducers, analog and digital transducers, inverse transducers, and it can be classified on the basis of principle that we are using. So this is how one can classify different kind of transducers. Today we are restricting ourselves to basic measurement of pressure and temperature, because these are the two quantities most oftenly being measured in different industrial applications. So starting first of all with pressure transducer, how one can define pressure? So according to our physics studies, we know that pressure is force per unit area, defined in units Newton per meter square or Pascal. This is what we are having as a primary information of pressure. How the pressure is generated? If I am applying force on certain object with certain area of cross section, that is going to generate some pressure. So pressure can be measured in different ways according to our requirement. So the requirements are absolute pressure measurement, where the reference is zero pressure, gauge pressure measurement, where gauge pressure will be the reference, and differential pressure measurement, where the pressure is measured at one object is being compared to the another pressure that you are having as a reference. So three different kind of measurements are there: absolute pressures, gauge pressures, and differential pressures, depending on the requirement that you are having. Different kind of transducers. Physically speaking, there are two different categories. One is gravitational kind of transducers, where gravity is making a base of measurement, while the second one is elastic measurement, where elasticity property is being exploited in order to measure the pressure. The example of gravitational measurement are manometer. Different manometers we are aware of, that is either a U-tube manometer you are having, or inclined tube manometer you are having, or you are having another kind of manometer, that is cistern manometer. So these are the manometers that you are going to look for. These manometers are having a liquid filled in a tube, and that you can utilize for measurement of pressure. The another category is elastic measurement, or elastic properties being exploited to measure the pressure. Ultimately, a force is applied to an object that is elastic, and whatever is the strain generated in that particular object is actually the measurement of pressure. So here the transducers are of elastic type: diaphragm type, capsules, bellow, Worden tubes, or helical tubes. These are the examples of elastic kind of transducers. Manometers. It measures the static pressure. It cannot be utilized for dynamic pressure measurement. So it is normally utilized for static measurement. It's simple U-tube. That U-tube is filled with a liquid. If pressure is equal on both sides, the level of both tubes will be same. So whatever is the difference of that level, that is indicating the difference of pressure on both sides. The expression is given here. Here the expression is given, that is H, that is height difference between two levels of pressure, or two meniscus that is existing in two different tubes, that is equivalent to pressure difference divided by rho and g, where rho is the density of the liquid that you are using. So if you want to go for lower pressure measurement, you can use light density materials. If you want to go for high pressure measurement, you can utilize a higher density material to be filled in the tube. Different variants are available for manometers depending on the requirement of your devices. The examples are simple U-tube that we are aware of, that may be available in our 11th-12th physics laboratories. The another variant is inclined tube manometer. U-tube manometer is having a limitation that you can measure distance or displacement or height in terms of not more than 1 millimeter. The resolution that is available is up to 1 millimeter. But if you do the same thing, whatever is the another tube can be slanted. So whatever is the angle that you are having, that theta will help in increasing the cos theta. So whatever is the measurement, that will be diagonal measurement, and that diagonal measurement will be extending the range of measurement. So you will be having a comparatively larger resolution of measurement. The technique does not vary at all, the technique remains same, but whatever is the height that you are measuring, that will be extended. So you will be having a little bit more resolution for the measurement. The third type is cistern measurement or well type measurement. The well type manometer is having a well or a reservoir made of whatever fluid that you are using. So, and in that particular reservoir, a thin tube or a very narrow tube is extracted. So from that extracted tube, we are trying to measure the pressure. So whatever is well, that is applied with the measuring pressure, while whatever is the height that is raised in the narrow tube, that will be giving direct measurement of the pressure. Furthermore, variants are also available. If I want to go for very minute measurement of pressure or very small pressure differences to be measured, then in that case, whatever nanometers, that can be supported with micrometer screws. So with help of micrometer screws, you can go up to 0.001 or even less, 0.01 millimeter or even lesser dimension. And such kind of micrometer screws are having a sensors placed at the tip of the micrometer screw that senses the touch of the meniscus of liquid. Either it is an electrical kind of sensor, or it can be a visible kind of sensor, optical kind of sensor. So both kind of sensors are available. So with this particular technique, it is possible that you will have a measurement of very, very small pressure. So this is something about manometers. Manometers are having a basic limitation that it can be utilized for static pressures, not for the dynamic pressure measurement. So if I want to go for dynamic pressure measurement or any other kind of measurement, I will have to go for another category, that is elastic kind of devices. The elastic kind of devices used for pressure measurement are starting with the first one, or the most basic, is diaphragm. The basic principle of this one is as good as using a balloon for blowing it off. So if you are putting some air in a balloon, the balloon gets expanded. Almost same thing happens here. A common pressure sensing element is a simple thin plate of metal that is placed or that is fastened at a periphery of a tube. Through the tube, whatever pressure that you are exerting, that pressure is trying to extend or expand the diaphragm from the center. So whatever is the diaphragm, that gets extended. Your diaphragm gets extended, and due to that extension of diaphragm, your diaphragm is making or generating some displacement. This displacement is proportional to the pressure that you have applied. This is the basic principle that is being exploited. Different kind of materials are being utilized for manufacturing of the element. Basically, elastic alloys of bronze, phosphor bronze, SS, or alloys like monel or nickel span S are being utilized. The thickness of this particular element is again of importance. So starting from smallest amount of pressure to be measured to higher pressure to be measured, the thickness goes on increasing in order to support a larger pressure sustainability. Two kind of diaphragms, flat and corrugated. Flat kind of diaphragms are whatever exactly I have defined for the definition of diaphragm, a simple metallic plate joined together at the periphery, and through the tube you are applying or exerting some pressure. Due to the pressure, the plate gets expanded. This is basically happening. Now whatever is this displacement cannot be very large. Normally this displacement will be in few millimeters. So if I want to have a larger deflection or larger displacement to be generated for the same amount of pressure to be applied, I will have to make the plate, instead of plane, corrugated. So I am having a corrugated plate, and that corrugated plate is generating larger amount of deflection. Whatever is deflection, that is comparatively 5 to 10 fold higher as compared to flat type. The advantage of flat type is disadvantage of flat type is having very small deflection, and it is also prone to a natural frequency of resonance, while corrugated kind of devices or corrugated diaphragms are offering larger deflections for the measurement. The larger deflection means you are able to measure it more with higher resolution, so resolution is comparatively larger. Different forms of corrugation is also available. The examples are sawtooth, trapezoidal, sinusoidal and toroidal. So these are the different formats available for the corrugation of the plate, and there is offers you different amount of displacement for the same pressure that you have applied. Another device that is used for measurement of pressure is capsules. Capsules are nothing but two diaphragms connected back to back at the periphery, and one of them is allowed with pressure insertion or allowing of the airflow. So two corrugated metal diaphragms sealed together at the periphery, that is what is the definition of capsule. In this particular form, one of the diaphragm is having an inlet port at the center. Through this inlet port, we are allowing the admission of the pressure. So pressure is allowed from this particular port. Now whenever this particular thing happens, the diaphragm starts expanding from the center. So whatever is the expansion of a particular diaphragm is doubled in case of capsule. So capsule is offering almost double displacement as compared to a diaphragm. In many versions, more than one capsules can be cascaded, means one capsule is cascaded with another one, or another can be cascaded to third one. Not more than three is a custom. So a single capsule or two capsules or three capsules are, I think, more than sufficient. Whatever is the another part of the capsule that is connected to a moving part. Now that moving part can be connected to pointer or can be connected to rack and pinion arrangement in order to make the displacement of a deflection pointer. So deflection pointer can be displaced using that particular device. Here displacement is proportional to the differential pressure, the pressure between the inner part of the diaphragm and exterior part of the diaphragm. It can be utilized as a single or cascaded one. So this is about the capsule kind of measurement. Here is a basic diagram of capsule shown. So this is how the capsule is supposed to work. From the inside or from the lower part, if you are exerting some pressure, so here if you are exerting some pressure, the capsule gets expanded in upward direction. So this particular thing is with the capsule. The another device that is more popular for measurement of pressure is Bourdon tube. As compared to diaphragm and capsule, Bourdon tube is more popularly utilized for measurement of pressure. Bourdon tubes are basically nothing but curved or twisted metallic tubes with an elliptical cross section at the center. What happens? They are sealed at the one end. So whenever you are trying to exert pressure from the open end, whatever is the curvature that tries to decrease, means it tries to straighten itself whenever the pressure is applied. So this is the basic phenomena that we are utilizing. How much straightening is taking place? So larger the pressure, larger is the straightening. Smaller the pressure, smaller is the straightening. So whatever is the angular displacement that it generates, that angular displacement is simply proportional to the amount of pressure that you have applied. So angular sensitivity is proportional to pressure that we have applied. Different formats of Bourdon tubes are available. C-shape, which is one of the most popular one, followed by helical, spiral and twisted. Bourdon tubes. Bourdon tubes are fabricated with metal alloys. Different metal alloys like brass, phosphor bronze, beryllium, copper, stainless steel, nickel alloys like nickel spancy are being utilized for measurement of pressure. It is very very sensitive to shock and vibration. So they are mostly utilized for static applications. Normally the kind of sensors that you are finding at the cylinders of gas, means pressure cylinders that is we are having, or at the domestic connections of pipelines, these all are indicating the pressure with help of Bourdon tubes. The advantage of this one is its cost effectiveness. It's very cheap and can be utilized for longer operation without any problem. The another thing is good repeatability and very good dynamic response. It can be utilized for a faster measurement and repeatability is excellent. So this is something about different kind of pressure transducers. Pressure transducers or sensors that what we have talked about, it converts the pressure in different kind of displacement or different another physical quantities. For example, starting with the diaphragm, whatever pressure that you are applying, that converts the pressure to the expansion of the diaphragm, means it converts it to displacement. Again, followed by the diaphragm is capsule, that again converts the pressure into displacement. Bellow is another transducer that is also converting the pressure into displacement. Last is Borden tube that also converts the pressure into angular displacement. But this is about the displacement. Ultimately, what we are interested in is measurement of electrical quantity that can be put on your meter. So if I want to go for direct measurement, then I will have to connect one of the whatever displacement that you are having to rack and pinion or mechanical arrangement so that it can be indicated on pointer. Tame ene pointer pe indicate kari sako. If you can indicate it on pointer with this particular technique, it is very possible that if you are having a simple scale that I am placing, so to the top of a particular diaphragm or to the top of a particular bellow, if we are placing a scale and that scale is having a vertical line, on vertical line we can mark it with pressures. So if that particular scale can be utilized for measurement of pressure. Another thing is rack and pinion arrangement. Whatever is the linear displacement can be converted to angular displacement, and that angular displacement can be marked on a semicircular kind of scale. Here is transduction from displacement to electrical quantity. The different transduction methods are potentiometric method. Whatever is the displacement that is generated from the pressure measurement transducers, that is connected to a potentiometer, and the potentiometer is giving nothing but the differential or the drop of voltage across the lower part of the potentiometer. So whatever is the voltage that you are having out of the potentiometer will be proportional to angular or linear displacement that you are having. Connection of strain gauge. If we are bonding strain gauge at different locations, either in diaphragm or in capsules or at bellows, whatever is the strain generated due to exertion of the pressure, that is changing the resistance of the strain gauge, and that difference of resistance can be measured using Wheaton bridge or some other bridges in order to give you the electrical output. LVDT, the displacement measuring device of reluctance, variable reluctance type. In this case, LVDT core can be connected directly to the displacement device like diaphragm or bellow, and whatever is the displacement of that particular device will generate differential output from the LVDT. Variable reluctance devices or variable capacitance devices. So different transduction methods can be utilized in order to convert whatever is the displacement due to pressure into electrical quantity. So ultimately what you will be having at the final